In 2023, Japan ran a digital trade deficit of about 5.5 trillion yen, or $37 billion, meaning that they imported trillions of yen more in software licenses, cloud, and other services than they exported. The deficit is growing. The 2023 amount is twice the amount it was in 2015. Japan's electronics hardware companies are iconic. Sony, Fujitsu, Hitachi, Panasonic, Canon, Sharp, Toshiba, the list goes on and on. But where is Japan's Microsoft, Oracle, Adobe, or SAP? In this video, we explore how Japan lost the software industry. Throughout the 20th century, MIDI, Japan's now famous economic policy ministry, sought to develop its computer industry. Their bogeyman, the American monster that haunted their dreams, was IBM. Big Blue first entered the land of the rising sun in 1925, selling tabulating machines through a local trading company. Then in 1937, IBM set up their own subsidiary, IBM Japan, but its assets were confiscated during World War II. They returned to Japan in 1949, just 1 year before a new Japanese law mandated that all foreign computer companies enter into joint ventures with local companies. These JVs were essentially forced technology transfers, RCA with Hitachi, GE with Toshiba, and Honeywell with NEC. But IBM owned 100% of IBM Japan and refused to budge on this even in the face of government demands. MIDI and IBM Japan repeatedly clashed over what can be introduced into the Japanese market. Even after IBM's computers were allowed in, government officials pushed customers to buy local and leverage the issuance of import licenses to enforce it. Yet despite these pressures, Japanese customers continued to favor IBM products due to their clear technical superiority. Yeah, times were different back then. In 1964, IBM introduced its breakthrough line of computers, the System 360. This alarmed MIDI and motivated them to sponsor the Super High Performance Computer Project. Lasting from 1966 to 1971, its objective was to beat the System 360. Previous MIDI efforts focused entirely on computer hardware, architecture, and processor design. But since one of the 360's key selling points was that software written for one computer would work on all of them, theoretically anyway, software could no longer be ignored. So to make the software for the project, in October 1966, MIDI sponsored the Japan Software Company, a joint venture between Hitachi, NEC, Fujitsu, and the Industrial Bank of Japan. The Japan Software Company was not Japan's first independent software company. That honor seems to go to Computer Applications, or CAC, but quite close. Japan Software's goal was to produce a quote-unquote common language software and common standards for the Super High Performance Computer Project, so basically a universal operating system for all of Japan's computers. Astoundingly ambitious considering that MIDI only funded Japan Software with 25% of the project's total 10 billion yen budget, it is clear that for MIDI, software was an afterthought. The Japan Software Company failed to achieve its goals amidst ballooning requirements from so many participants. As difficulties intensified, management failed to acquire any outside sales and lost the confidence of its workers. After government subsidies ended, the company closed in 1972. So what software did the Japanese hardware makers use for their systems? Well, IBM's. In 1969, the threat of an American antitrust lawsuit made IBM unbundle their software and hardware. This was a major milestone in technology industrial history. Previously, IBM and other computer companies included software as part of an overall computing services bundle. Customers wanting a particular software package often waited for IBM to eventually produce it and give it to them. The unbundling assigned a price to what before was given away for free, and it also let small software companies compete against giants like IBM. Many companies started with software that either complemented or extended the functionality of existing IBM packages. So in the United States, the IBM unbundling created the software industry as we know it today. I did a video about this a while ago that I think would be a fun watch here. But in Japan, something different happened. There, IBM's unbundling let the Japanese computer makers set up software subsidiaries and quote-unquote adopt IBM's specifications via reverse engineering. This began as early as 1971 when Fujitsu began selling a quote-unquote IBM-compatible mainframe marketed as being as fast as IBM's, but cheaper. A collaboration with Gene Amdahl, the former chief architect of the System 360, helped Fujitsu refine this compatibility. Japanese computer companies almost never used the software as it was. The software had to be modified to display Japanese kanji symbols, and every company had their own approach to doing this. Furthermore, the software was often modified for customers' existing business practices. The Japanese computer companies liked this because it locked in the customer and let them charge more. So at the risk of oversimplification, one can say that the Japanese computer companies became little IBMs of their own. You can argue that it was the only way companies like Fujitsu, Hitachi, or NEC could have survived their persistent technological lag against the Americans for so long. Just one little issue with this use of reverse-engineered IBM software. It was theft and illegal. Before a decade plus after it started happening in Japan, IBM did little about it for varying reasons. First, definitive copyright protections did not extend to software until the Copyright Act of 1976 legislation took action in 1978. But even after that, IBM had far bigger fish to fry, namely defending against the Titanic antitrust case brought against it in the late 1960s with the goal of breaking it up. That only ended in 1982 after the US government realized that it was litigating ghosts. IBM was then rapidly losing share with PC clones flooding the market. With that resolved, IBM could finally turn to the ongoing theft of its software by Japanese companies like Fujitsu. In 1982, they confronted Fujitsu, Hitachi, and others with these allegations. Hitachi and Fujitsu argued that since the System 360 OS was in the public domain at the time they adopted it, they can also use softwares derived from it, like the System 370 OS and so on. They also argued that IBM's software specifications were so widely used that they were a standard and thus not subject to copyright protection. So IBM took the case to its new friend, the US government. In the early 1980s, the government arrested 18 Japanese employees, some quite senior, from the Hitachi and Mitsubishi Electric companies in an elaborate sting operation and charged them with paying money to steal technical secrets from IBM. The IBM spy case, as it was called, stirred up bad feelings on both sides of the Pacific. The United States, then going through a challenging recession and deeply insecure about what it felt was a declining global competitiveness, and Japan, feeling that they were being set up and that the United States was trying to undercut their rise as a world power. They argued that Japanese firms like Nintendo and Sega suffered copyright damage in the US too. Good times. For all that huffing and puffing, it was unquestionable that the Japanese computer firms copied IBM's work, right down to the errors. So in the end, they came to a settlement. Fujitsu paid a one-time lump sum plus annual licensing fees as high as $60 million a year. Fujitsu also agreed to respect IBM IP rights going forward. Such software fees seriously threatened the computer maker's competitiveness. The Japanese government tried to step in to save their national champion computer firms. In 1985, MIDI proposed to amend its copyright laws to limit protections on software from the 50-year international standard to just 15 years. This obviously failed to take hold. That MIDI would even consider that makes it clear how serious things were. For years, Japanese computer companies built a whole business on top of closed-source software made by foreigners. Now that was coming back to bite them in the butt. The Japanese government recognized thus a serious software crisis. Without domestic alternatives, Japanese tech providers will always remain dependent on software imports from companies like IBM or Microsoft. But one major obstacle was an ongoing big shortage of qualified, productive software programmers in Japan. Why? Well, that is a major topic in of itself, but a few things come to mind. First, Japanese universities did not have enough qualified teachers in computer science and software. Most computer science professors then trained in other disciplines like math. Teachers also lagged in picking up on the latest compute trends for their curriculums. Lacking English bilingual abilities and overseas experience contributed to this lag. Second, software engineering was not seen as a very attractive job. The biggest employers of software developers in Japan are the software development arms of larger business families operating on a lifetime employment system. There, software developers were not customer-facing and thus lacked career progression. Moreover, the work did not pay very well and was not very fulfilling, mostly boring customization or maintenance code monkeying. This somewhat persists. In 2010, the former CEO of Infosys estimated that 80% of Japan's software spend went to maintaining existing systems. To compare, this was no more than 60% in the West. But really, we should not expect big companies to be the tip of the spear in promoting programming's sexiness as an industry. That role is fulfilled by startups. Such startups also serve as centers of technological dynamism in the industry. So we come to my third point, a lack of Japanese software startups. Over in the United States, the 1980s saw the founding of independent software giants like Adobe, Intuit, Synopsys, Cadence, Lotus, Electronic Arts, and Autodesk, not to mention Microsoft and Oracle, which were founded in the late 1970s, but started hitting their stride in the 1980s. Such big independent companies failed to emerge in 1980s Japan, either for lack of customer acceptance or insufficient venture capital investment, an unwieldy lifetime employment system, a cultural lack of initiative slash risk-taking, take your pick. One relevant issue that industrial people considered was that Japanese programmers lacked a quote-unquote good software environment to develop software in. With the industry all working on custom software, there was no widely accepted platform or operating system that the broader industry could agree to all use, independent of hardware. This left Japanese engineers quite unproductive. A number of options presented themselves, and one possible pathway was Tron, a domestic OS project initiated in 1984 by Dr. Ken Sakamura of the University of Tokyo. It sought to create a quote-unquote open operating system to break the tightening grip of Microsoft software and Intel hardware. It did not produce any actual source code, but rather a set of interfaces and design guidelines, more like POSIX, the IEEE's operating system standards, rather than like a Linux kernel. The most important Tron variant was the Business Tron, or BTron. PC makers like Matsushita Electric adopted the standards and started producing a BTron-compliant PC for use in Japanese schools like the PCs from Acorn Computers in the UK. But then in April 1989, the US Trade Representative Office specifically listed BTron as a potential Japanese trade barrier. The Tron Association protested, and the office later removed that mention, but the damage was done. Japanese microprocessor companies, then already embroiled in the US-Japan semiconductor kerfuffle, pulled out, causing BTron to collapse. Tron is still around. The Nintendo Switch's Joy-Con controllers use an OS that is Tron-compliant, though Tron couldn't save those controllers from drifting so hard with minimal use. And the Hayabusa 2 space probe that went to an asteroid and came back with some stuff uses a Tron OS variant. So yeah, Tron does some cool stuff. Sakamura later accused the US government of strangling BTron in the cradle. Maybe. But I am more of the opinion that BTron's lack of applications and general slowness probably made it a dead end from the start. In 1985, as the BTron thing played out, another MIDI-sponsored consortium kicked off the 5-year Software Industrialized Generators and Maintenance Aids, or SIGMA, project. Funded with 25 billion yen, SIGMA's lofty goal was to drastically improve the productivity of Japanese programmers. The foreign media played up that angle, but in reality, what the project did was develop standards, configurations, and applications for a line of networked Unix workstation computers. As you might guess, SIGMA fell far short of its ultimate goals, but it did cause Fujitsu, Hitachi, and NEC to transition from their old IBM platforms to Unix, licensed from AT&T. But in classic Japanese and Unix fashion, they heavily customized it again. Fujitsu had UTSM, NEC Super UX, and Hitachi High UX. Mainframes and the supercomputers are one area where the old Japanese playbooks still worked like a charm. Adopting Unix gave Fujitsu and company a bit of a second wind. In the 1990s, Japan made some of the world's fastest supercomputers, challenging the famed Cray Research Company. Unfortunately, it remained a very niche success. In 1990, the Japanese real estate bubble popped, sending the country into its infamous years-long recession. Customers could no longer afford expensive software modifications. The big Japanese mainframe makers like Fujitsu and Hitachi struggled to adapt to this new cost-conscious environment, entering a slow, long-term decline. More importantly, the real estate crash struck at the heart of Japanese confidences. The United States started pulling away on the basis of its long-held competitive advantages in software, and suddenly principles long-held to heart at MIDI were called into question. Throughout the decades, MIDI's playbook was to give their domestic champion some money and a popular product. MIDI told those companies to reverse engineer the product and figure out how to make more of it cheaper than anyone else can. Such products would then be sold abroad. This worked well for industrial items like steel or automobiles, but software can already be easily copied. What makes one software package more successful than another isn't quote-unquote replication economics, but rather widely held standards, networks of applications or users, and consumer familiarity. As consumer products got more reliant on their operating software, it got harder for Japan's one-time mighty consumer companies to compete in the open market. The PC is a classic case of a very software-heavy consumer electronics product that Japan wrong-footed. For a decade or more, NEC owned the domestic market of PCs thanks to a hardware-accelerated version of MS-DOS capable of handling the Japanese language, the PC-98. But in the early 1990s, IBM, Microsoft, and Intel finally cracked NEC's stagnant PC monopoly. A new version of DOS with Japanese language support opened the door for foreign-made software and hardware to finally enter the Japanese market. This time, the Japanese government and MIDI decided to let it play out, deciding a more globalized approach was necessary. Now fully exposed to the market, NEC's overpriced and relatively simple products crumbled. There is no doubt that the fall of the NEC PC-98 was a boon for consumers, but it also cemented Microsoft's domination of the Japanese market. No domestic Japanese software maker has since mounted a credible challenge to the American giant. A similar game played out a few years later. Japanese telecom NTT Docomo created a mobile 2G web browser, which they developed into a mobile internet service called iMode. Launched in 1999, it became quite popular, with over 40 million subscribers in 2003. NTT sought to export this standard abroad, marketing it as another revenue generator for telecoms tapped out in mobile telephony. Unfortunately, iMode failed to take hold abroad, in part due to a lack of adoption by handset partners. The window of opportunity then closed with the release of the iPhone and its extremely rich application ecosystem. Before we conclude, I want to thank a friend of the channel who suggested this topic during a Tokyo meetup. Or not thank, since I found this one exceptionally difficult. Do you know how hard it is to prove a negative? In closing, I would like to emphasize that Japan does have a software industry. It is actually quite large. The core issue is that Japan's software landscape remains dominated by either custom-made packages with no greater sales potential or imported products made abroad. And for all of its industrial policies, Japan's brightest spot in software is probably gaming. And that is despite issues on the talent side clearing up. I have personally heard that Japanese software programmers are quite good without needing American-scale salaries. The Ruby language was first produced by a Japanese, though the Rails framework that made it famous was done by a Danish guy. Japan Inc.'s continued lag in the global software industry has been a point of discussion across multiple technological eras. I've heard few suggestions on how to fix it. And to be honest with you, I struggle to come up with coherent policy answers as well. Alright everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.